Hey there, and welcome to Interama, a brand new Planet Coaster series that's starting today. And man, it's been quite a while since I last played Planet Coaster. Just to give you an idea of how long ago that was, even though there was an episode 2 weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago, where I wrapped Altos Paradise, our previous project. But I mean, really building things in Planet Coaster? I mean, last time I did that, I had to use the Frontier launcher. It wasn't even available on Steam, so that's how long ago it was. And I was just happy to sort of come back to it. It took me quite a while to sort of get the hang of it again, because first of all, I forgot all the shortcuts and everything else. And also, there were changes in the UI during this, I guess, this period that I wasn't playing the game for. I was hoping that the paths were a little bit improved. Unfortunately, there are some improvements when it comes to pathing, but like laying them down is still as annoying as it used to be. I was hoping that they would like somehow, I don't know, let you like click and drag, which is what I was hoping it would work, or how it would work, but that was not the case. In fact, so this last week where I recorded this episode in, you know, multiple sessions, I pretty much logged like 10 hours into the game just producing this very first episode. There's going to be quite a bit of progress on this one, and we'll get to the history of what Interama is, because I'm actually sort of building a park that exists in real life, or at least used to exist until like very recently. But we'll get to that in a moment. What I was saying is that, yeah, just getting used to the new UI and plopping things and even browsing, you know, the insane number of new materials and assets that we get to play with. It's actually remarkable. We no longer have to only do pirate-based maps, which is quite refreshing, actually. It gives you a little bit more creative freedom, even though, I mean, I like being restrained by, you know, things, in this case, the number of assets, which still, you know, not amazing, but it's certainly a lot more flexible. And you'll see me try during this time lapse a whole bunch of different things in order to get, you know, the result that I want. So let me tell you a little bit about this this project. So Interama is a park that used to exist, or yeah, it was. That was the first name of the park back in 1982 when it first opened. The construction actually began in the late 70s, 1978 to be exact. And this park was located in Buenos Aires in Argentina. I happened to visit this park a couple times myself, but it's sort of it started being built by a private company, and then a year later, after it was open, the government took over. So pretty much like the entire history of the park was owned by the government, which makes it a bit of a strange park, because I'm not gonna say a low budget park, because like the rides were actually really like top notch back when it was open. In fact, many of the roller coasters, which it has quite a few actually, are still there, even though they were completely abandoned, and some of them never even run, are like, even like all the weeds and grass are just growing around them, but the actual conditions of the rides are still like very, very good, even though, like I said, they were completely left for dead for many, many years, decades actually. So let me tell you a little bit more about this. So the lot where the park sits, it's 188 acres, where it's mostly green space. There were quite a few attractions, actually 58 in total. Most of them were supplied by this Swiss company called Intamin, which is actually pretty famous for, you know, different theme parks around the world. And like I said, it had 5 roller coasters, which we'll get to build. I don't know if you're gonna build exactly all 5 of them. And by the way, this is also something to consider. I'm not hoping to create like a 100% realistic version of this. I'm trying to like use it as a base inspiration, and the layout will be very, very similar. But I'm not looking to copy exactly everything to the T, because it's just not possible. The tools that we have are not detailed enough for me to achieve that. But I'm using that as a reference to sort of guide myself. And I think that was one of the main reasons why I was kind of burned from the previous Planet Coaster series is because I had no sort of guide or sort of roadmap to aim for. So I think in this case, hopefully this would help. And I don't know, I just thought it was an interesting project. And by the way, since you might have noticed that since this project started in 1982, or first opened in 1982, and it was huge during the 80s, hence the 80s theme that you saw at the intro, which I thought it was appropriate, even with the like very obnoxious music and like neon colors and like very saturated stuff. I was even gonna add like a VHS effect on it. I thought it was like way too over the top for that, but man, I was so close to like adding some like VHS tracking effect. Many of you probably weren't even born when VHS was a thing, but I just thought it was funny. I mean, this park was open, like I said, in 1982, and that was like 4 years before I was born, so you can do the math right there. I'm sure it just surprised quite a few of you. But let me tell you a little bit more about the park. So the park is actually split into five areas. I'm probably showing you a map on the screen right now. There's the international area or corner of the map, the fantasy, the Latin, the carnival, and the future areas. And or the lands, I guess. Technically, that's usually what theme parks call these things. And right there in the middle of the future area, there is the, I guess, the centerpiece of this whole park, which is the observation tower, or the space tower, actually, is what they call it there. It's 220 meters tall, or 660 feet. So it's the tallest man-made point in the country. And for a while, it was the tallest structure in entire South America. It had, at the time, I think it had the fastest elevators in the world. So it was a big deal. It wasn't something like tiny. It was a huge, huge park. And the tower is still standing there, and I think they're going to keep it. It was first, like I said, opened in 1982, and it was first closed in 2003. Many of the rides were like being closed as the time passed, between, you know, the 80s and the early 2000s. Then it was reopened again in February 2007, closed again in March 2008, reopened once more in September 2013, and the final shutdown was just last year, 2016. And now they're like officially, I mean, every time it opened and closed, many, many more rides were being shut down, to the point where like only one carousel was even working at the time, or at that point. And right now they're shutting it down for good because they're turning that whole park into the Olympic Village for the 2018 Youth Olympics, which will be hosted in Buenos Aires. So they're gonna be building, you know, actual housing for the athletes and all that. So eventually I think they're gonna turn it into like a bit of a neighborhood slash, you know, open park, green space kind of area. They're gonna keep the tower, but it's yeah, as a theme park, they're actually dismantling everything. You can still, I'm gonna include a link in the description. You can still go on Google Maps and sort of get it's all 3D, so you can actually see the rides or at least what's left of them. The whole, for example, I think fantasy area or the international area is completely empty. It's just like it's all concrete, because at some point during one of the reopened and closed periods, they turned that whole area into like a concert area. Like it was actually called City of Rock or something like that, and many bands played over there. So it was mostly flattened or leveled just to allow people to go in and watch music shows. But yeah. It's kind of the whole history of this park is really, really interesting if you're into that kind of thing. As the episodes progress and we start working on specific rides, I will give you more details into the actual history behind it. And I'm just giving you some, like, you know, stats and facts at this point. But I thought it was a nice theme for a theme park. I mean, it has I think it ticks every checkbox in the list of, you know, features that a theme park should have. Like I said, roller coasters, all sorts of flat rides, It even has a little train that goes around in a loop. So we're going to be in this episode, actually, and you'll just see it in a moment. We're actually going to be building the first bridge for the little train that loops around the park. So now let's talk a little bit about what I'm doing here on the time lapse. I'm starting working on the fences because this is sort of the main entrance where people would technically have to sort of pay their ticket in order to get in. And actually that brings me to something that I wanted to point out, which is the fact that these are like ticket booths. That's where the entrance is right now. Like where those like little bollards on the side with the little metal door is. That's just the entrance of the park. And I realized that inside of shops and facilities, inside of that menu, there's a ticket booth that's in addition to the entrance. So I wasn't sure which one should I put in. I don't know why you need two. I guess in real life, if you go to like Universal or anything or Disney or any of those parks, I guess, yeah, you pay first and then you enter it after you get your ticket. But in a game like this, it doesn't really make that much sense. So I'm not sure if I should actually put down the ticket booth or if I can just like leave it like that and assume that people just pay their ticket as they go in through those booths that I designed just a second ago. I don't know. Remember, this series is mostly aesthetic driven in a way. I'm trying to get the best looking park more than a park that is economically viable. As you can see, I'm using the unlimited money modifier or whatever. And I really don't care about the rating and all that. I guess I will pay some attention to that. But just so you know, this if you're into Planet Coaster because of the simulation and like all like the park management and stuff, like I really don't care about any of that. So this may not be the series for you. I'm just trying to get the most aesthetically pleasing park that works and makes sense. But that's sort of my goal. Not really interested in any of the other game mechanics. And that's usually the theme for my channel in general. I like doing like eye candy things more than super functional and like efficient and money making tactics. So that pretty much set the tone for this series. Just one more thing before I actually go into the details of what I'm building here. In terms of schedule, I'm hoping to do at least one video every 2 weeks. Right now I'm like really pumped and I want to get more videos out soon. But obviously they take quite a bit of time to produce. It's not easy. If you're new to my channel right now, and if you're watching this, I tend to put a lot of effort into producing my episodes, like between the editing, the music mixing, even the motion graphics at the beginning, like I put a lot of work and effort on each episode. So that's why I don't post videos so often. Quality over quality, I guess, is the motto for this channel in a bit. So these episodes take quite a bit of time to do, and I also like to show quite a bit of progress in each one of them. In this episode, I feel like we accomplished quite a bit, and in fact, I still think at the end of it, we'll still need to add a lot more details and work on a lot more things. So it's it's a never-ending battle working on each one of these episodes, and that is why I'm gonna try to post videos as often as I can. But given my schedule and given how I don't do YouTube for a living. This is just a hobby of mine, so. I do try to keep a schedule and keep it steady and keep videos out as often as I can, but sometimes I can't. So I'm going to try to do at least one video every 2 weeks, and we'll see how it goes. It may be faster than that, it may be slower than that. If you want to know exactly when any other changes in schedule are, the best way to get a hold of me or read about that is Twitter, twitter.com/RootToaster. You should definitely follow me there. I know I say it on every single episode, but it's true. All these time that I wasn't posting videos or anything like that, I was you know, very, very active there in answering questions and, you know, taking suggestions and things like that. So yeah, just keep that in mind. If you all of a sudden don't see another Planet Coaster episode for a while, I probably tweeted about it. That's it. All right, so what I'm doing here is, I think it's pretty self-explanatory at this point, but I created two little houses on each side of the of this like main entrance, where one of them has an information kiosk and the other one is just a bathroom, which actually matches you know, the layout of the original park, which literally has an information booth and a bathroom right on the entrance. And right here, I'm just laying down the foundations for this bridge where the train will be, you know, sort of going above. And I put down those two janitors. Actually, I put only one, but then accidentally put another one and immediately fired the janitor. So in a moment, you'll probably see him like weeping and like looking down because I just fired him, which is kind of hilarious. As I was working on this, I realized that I'm probably gonna need more than one janitor, so I wanted to rehire that person, but no, he was like, nope. The UI doesn't allow you to rehire someone that you just fired, so that's kind of unfortunate. But I guess it doesn't really matter. I can hire more people. Eventually, I'm sure he will apply for a job again. And what I'm doing here is I'm using these like metal beams that, I mean, this the bridge in real life is it's a metal structure, and it's more of an overpass than a bridge actually, but I was trying to like sort of integrate it with the fences that we have all around this entrance and try to mirror, you know, the different this structure as much as I could so that it's perfectly symmetrical or to some extent. And obviously I tried to like create the path in the middle there with some gaps on the side. And this is a problem that I think we're going to start facing a lot in this project, which is I want areas that are like 100% path and then a building. And I want people to avoid the walls and the buildings. And it's just not doable if you do it that way. If you make everything one huge path and you put buildings on top of it, people will like clip through the buildings. And I wasn't happy with that idea. So there's a few tricks that I'm going to be using, you know, during the course of this series to sort of avoid that. I know that if you put, there's a category inside of scenery, I can't remember the name, but basically the category that has the benches and the trash bins and all those assets, they have hitboxes. So visitors from park would not would avoid that area because they will consider it, you know, a non-walkable area. And you can kind of use that to limit. So for example, you'll see in a moment later during this time lapse that I put a few trash cans right next to the entrance of the bathroom. And that pretty much helps people clip through some wooden pillars that I'm going to put in a moment. I guess I'm getting ahead of myself right now, but yeah. It's kind of tricky getting it right the first time, but I mean, that's probably why I spent so much time getting this first episode out, because I was like learning all these tips and tricks. I even asked a couple questions to Silver Red, who kindly explained to me how to do some awesome cinematics, even though the game doesn't allow you to even go full screen, which is also another, I mean, for some reason I keep comparing this game to City Skylines. And man, just Cities Skylines is so much better at so many other things that it's, I mean, I know I'm comparing pears with apples right now. I know that doesn't make any sense, but there are a few things that I like by default, I expect from the game that are not as such. So it's really hard not to make the comparison, but I guess I should probably stop doing that because it doesn't make sense, right? These are completely different games made for very different things, and you just have to get used to it. And like I said, all these limitations are actually a good thing. You can sort of direct your creativity and or limit your creativity and actually come up with better solutions to, I guess, these kinds of problems. And over here, what I'm doing is just adding a few more details to this little info kiosk slash house. It's really that big. I know it doesn't make sense for an information booth to be this big, but I'm sure this is actually being used in real life for offices. Like, you know, whoever manages this park also like works out of one of these tiny houses. Probably not on the bathroom construction that's on the other side, but definitely being used for more than just providing information to guests. And that little, by the way, yeah, I wanted to mention this. The theme, the colors of that there are being used in this park, or at least the I actually have a photo a folder with tons of reference photos, and the theme for many of these elements, they're like really terrible colors. Like they use this like ugly wood like pillars and decorations. I don't know why they chose that ugly like military mossy green. But I just decided to keep it. I mean, just try to stay true to like the essence of this park as much as I could. I did add a few signs that were not present in the reference photos and things like that, just to like make it a little bit more friendly. But yeah, in some areas, like for example, the entrance, it doesn't have any signs or anything. It has some flags, but I couldn't find flags in the game. I was actually surprised by that. I went to add some flags to like the main entrance and there weren't any. I know there's like this sort of flying banners from like castles, but I wanted to add like a normal flag and that wasn't a thing. So I went into the Steam Workshop and I couldn't figure it out. And maybe you can help me with this in the comments. Please let me know if I'm missing something. But from what I've seen, all of the assets in the Steam Workshop are simply things people created with the current materials. There aren't any new things. The only new thing I was able to find, or I think new thing, maybe I even missed it on the vanilla game, but I found this like custom signs, basically some like lit up letters that are sort of glow in the dark. I don't know, they have lights. And they look great, but I subscribed to those. And I wasn't able to find them in the game at all. Like I used the search on every single one of these tabs and I just couldn't find it. So I'm not sure am I doing something wrong right now? I don't really get it. I was expecting it to be more like, you know, like Cities Skylines where you just subscribe to the thing and it just shows up in the menu. You maybe have to turn it on, but I even looked for like a, like some sort of content manager thing in game and I couldn't find any. So yeah, it was quite strange. And also, I mean, to me, the strangest thing was that there weren't any like custom models or anything in the Steam Workshop, as far as I can tell. Again, please do correct me in the comment section if I'm wrong, but I think this game could benefit tremendously from custom assets like that. I think that will be great. In fact, one feature, and this is probably not gonna be a custom asset for the game, but something that I'm hoping will at some point get released for this game is like flying gondolas. So this park in real life actually features three gondola station. I think it forms like a triangle where you can like basically go from one end to the other of the same park and just above everyone else. So unfortunately that is not a feature in Planet Coaster as of now, but hopefully, you know, keep my fingers crossed that will come in as a, you know, as an update at some point in the future. Now, what the hell am I doing here? That's a very good question. So this train that goes by sort of the entrance here, it's actually elevated and it's for this whole part, it just sits on basically terrain that's elevated. And right next to it, there will be a lake. Actually, the whole park has several like tiny little ponds and lakes, so we'll get to add a few of those as well. As I said before, at the beginning of this time lapse, this park pretty much features all of the things that you want to build in a theme park for the most part. So I thought it was, like I said, a perfect fit just because of that. I mean, we have trains, we have roller coasters, we have ponds, we have tons of flat rides. In fact, there's a few flat rides that are literally the same. Like for example, the Rocktopus, there is literally a Rocktopus, or was a Rocktopus in this park, which is kind of hilarious. So yeah, what I'm doing here is trying to like integrate this bridge, this metal structure into the terrain as much as I could. This, by the way, was my first attempt at terraforming in this game, like really terraforming in this game. And I actually learned a lot after, you know, after a little while. So my first attempt wasn't amazing, but I'm definitely getting the hang of it. And hopefully the next couple episodes, I'll do a much better job, much faster. And as you can see there was like this patch of grass that I just couldn't get down. And then I realized there was a checkbox that prevented me from doing so. But I learned that way later down the road. Now, one thing that I forgot to mention yet is I went ahead and tried to add detail by just using the paths themselves and using like the different patterns that they have. So I mean, and if you go look at that Google Maps link that I put in the description, where you can see the actual, you know, park, you'll see that there's a ton of patterns on the floor entering the park. And I mean, obviously I don't have enough resolution on this, you know, tile sets, but I try to do my best to sort of replicate that design and that pattern. And I'm actually really happy with how it came out. I wish that if you were able to do diagonal lines instead of just squares or rounded squares or even concave, like border radios, if that makes any sense, would be really, really useful. If there's a way to do that, again, please let me know in the comments. I think I'm gonna learn a ton from many of you who have been playing this game for a lot longer. In fact, I've been watching several YouTube videos before, you know, before recording this one, or sort of in preparation for this series. I learned so much just by watching other people, and I hope that you like get a few ideas or learn a few things from this series as well. That's sort of the goal here. I tend to apply quite a bit of the feedback that it's given by you, the viewers. yeah, it's quite of an interesting learning curve. And I mean, one thing that I thought was going to be really, really hard is to like add detail to this park. And I realized that it's actually not that hard. It's much, much easier than it used to be. I think the key here is shortcuts are your friends. You really want to learn how to use shortcuts. After I forced myself, and I think you need to do this at first, sort of force yourself to use shortcuts, even though you can go with your mouse and click. You can even tell like at the first clips of these time lapse, compared to the last ones, I'm like using shortcuts for everything. It just speeds up your workflow so much. It's like, yeah, you don't want to do the point and click thing anymore at all. Like you want to use shortcuts for everything. So I highly encourage you to like, you know, do that, like force yourself to use shortcuts. You will not be disappointed, and you're going to make a lot of progress much, much faster, which is sort of the goal here. You don't want to be stuck with one thing. Cause I mean, that at least for me personally is what kills my creativity. Like I have these amazing ideas, but if it takes so much to materialize, then I slowly like lose interest. So I don't know, that may be just me, but if you have the sort of the same problem, maybe that will help. And yeah, we're now officially finishing this episode. If you're excited where this series is going, I highly encourage you to go click that little thumbs up button. If we can get to like, I don't know, 37 likes, that'd be great. I think that will be very ambitious, but still pretty doable, hopefully. If you didn't enjoy the series, you can also dislike it. That, you know, it's not the end of the world, but at least it will tell me that you did enjoy it. I don't know. Maybe that will help me create better content for you in the future. Just a quick announcement, City Skylines is starting soon. So if you want to know exactly when that happens, like I said before, Twitter is the way to know those things. Twitter.com/strictoaster. Also, I have a Facebook page that I post to often, facebook.com/strictoaster. All those links are in the description. There's a link to the full playlist right under this video. So you can watch this and future episodes of Interama right there in case you missed one. But that does it for me. That does it for episode one. And man, this is really exciting. It's just starting a new series is always really, really exciting. So if you're new to the channel, please click that big red subscribe button that's underneath this video player as well. And make sure to click that little bell icon that apparently notifies you, because subscribing is not enough anymore. I don't know why YouTube does this thing sometimes. But unfortunately, that's all that I have to say for now. Next up, there will be some amazing cinematics paired with some really, really good 80s music. And yeah, that's it for this episode. Thank you all for watching, and really hope to see you in the next one.